We're now ready to begin with the session as everybody has joined in. Wherever you find something extraordinary, you'll find the fingerprints of a great teacher. In the words of our former President of India, late Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who also inaugurated Christ College Rajkot in 2001, expressed his views on teaching, saying, "Teaching is a very noble profession that shapes the character, caliber, and future of an individual." I, Bhavisha Vyas, extend pleasant greetings of the day to our eminent teacher for the day, Dr. Sanjay Mukherjee, Head and Professor, Department of English and Comparative Literary Studies, Saurashtra University, Rajkot, the Reverend Father Dr. Benny Joseph, Director of Christ Campus, Dr. Yvonne Fernandez, Principal, Christ College, Ms. Nymphia Gopia, Principal, Christ Polytechnic Institute, and the esteemed faculty members on Christ Campus. I take this opportunity to wish my teachers and colleagues a very happy Teachers' Day. I would now like to request Dr. Father Benny Joseph to address the scholastic gathering.
Thank you, Bhavisha. Am I audible, Bhavisha?
Yes, Father.
Yeah. A very good morning to all of you. At the very outset, I wish all the teachers on the campus and also our keynote speaker of the day, Dr. Sanjay Mukherjee, a happy Teachers' Day, and all the blessings of the day. As all of us know, we are carrying out a novel course of imparting knowledge to the students, the coming generation. And it is our responsibility to guide them and lead them and kindle the light of knowledge in their life. And probably in the history of the education field, there may not have been a day like this, a virtual celebration or the Teachers' Day celebration in a virtual manner. For the first time we are facing such a situation. Even during this particular situation or this pandemic situation, all the teachers living apart all their comforts and enjoyments, they are engaged in teaching. Even when other people were in lockdown, we were all working and imparting knowledge to the students. I appreciate and place on record the effort taken by all the teachers on the campus for carrying out the teaching job without any interruption, even during this pandemic situation. I wish all of you, once again, all the felicitations and greetings of the day, and invoke God's blessings on all of us. And I take this opportunity to welcome and thank Dr. Sanjay Mukherjee for accepting our invitation and deliver a talk on the role of teachers, especially in reference to this pandemic situation. I wish all of you once again a great day. I request Sanjay sir to take up and deliver this. Thank you.
Thank you, Father. We have with us today Dr. Sanjay Mukherjee. He has been on our campus on various occasions and is also familiar to all of us. But to follow the order of the day, may I formally introduce Dr. Sanjay Mukherjee. Dr. Sanjay Mukherjee completed his graduation and post-graduation studies from the Department of English, MS University, Bagra. He has a PhD in British Cultural Criticism under the guidance of the renowned scholar, late Professor Avdesh Kumar Singh. He is currently Professor and Head in the Department of English and Comparative Literary Studies, Saurashtra University, Rajkot, with an experience of about 25 years of PG teaching and research, with the Dollar Rai Markand Best Research Award in 2007 by the Saurashtra University. 7 students have been awarded their PhDs under his guidance till now, and 7 more are working on their doctorate dissertation. His publications include, besides more than 20 papers and translations, 5 books: English Literature in the Romantic and Victorian Period, 1798 to 1914, Survey and Interpretation, Critical Discourse and Colonialism, Image of India, Prism of British Literary Constructs, Approaching Shakespeare Through Comparative Literature, and Approaching Shakespeare Through Literary Theory and Adaptation. In 2011, he was awarded the Fulbright Equivalent SUSI Fellowship for an academic visit to the University of Louisville, Kentucky, USA. He was also invited by the University of British Columbia, Canada, at their Center for Women's and Gender Studies in 2008. He writes poems, though infrequently, some of which have been published. One of his poems, Speaking of a Paradise, found a special mention by the Distinguished International Jury of the 5th Rabindranath Tagore Award in May 2015. Mukherjee sir has been a teacher, mentor and guide to all of us at the Department of English, Christ College, and through first-hand experience, we know that he is an erudite scholar, passionate, committed, sincere and diligent educator, epitome of intellectual prowess. All these epithets sum up that he is the quintessence of an ideal teacher. May I now humbly request Mukherjee sir to commence his online talk on the responsibility of a teacher today.
Thank you very much indeed, Bhavisha. I take this opportunity to thank the Cultural Club of Team Christ College. I express my deep sense of gratitude to Father Benny and all the office bearers, Principal Ma'am Fernandez, and this young 65 plus team of committed teachers that Father Benny is really very proud of. I have been to Christ College, it has been mentioned, I have always loved coming to Christ College. I have, since the very my first visit to the college, there is a sense of the aura, the energy that I like of that place itself has always made me wanting to come back to this place. And of course, as Bhavisha rightly mentioned, somehow or the other, till now, the English department has been an alumni team of our department. And it's such a joy, it's a feeling that one cannot explain, because no certificate can bring this feeling when one sees our own student now joining the ranks of teachers. So they become the fraternity, and this sense of joy, this sense of pride that the department has, actually words fall short for this. So I am indeed very honored to be amongst you all. Now, when Parth invited me first, I was a little bit of a dilemma, because on Teachers' Day, students keep saying all goody-goody things about teachers, And so what am I to say to the teachers who are fellow teachers, fellow journey men and women in this path of knowledge? As Father Benny rightly said, this light of knowledge, the commitment of an institution to keep burning the light of knowledge. What am I to add further to you all committed people who are already there, who know your responsibility? And when I thought of knowing our responsibility, then I thought, well, why not think aloud, keeping you all, as you see me virtually and I see you virtually. It's not a talk or a lecture that I wish to offer to you today, but let us all think aloud on this word called responsibility. And therefore, I thought it would not be out of place in the context that we are living today to revisit this word responsibility of a teacher. And therefore, I asked my son. You see, often people say that parents are the first teachers, parents are the first teachers. I tested myself today in the morning. And when we woke up and I asked my 13-year-old son, Debu, I said, Debu, do you remember that you used to have word splashes when you were a kiddo? I must put it on record that for his age, Debu reads quite far more than I used to do it at my age. So he said, yes, I do remember the word splashes and all that. Why do you ask me that? So I said, look, this is the word responsibility. And look, if you put the word splash, it leads to at least these 10 different connotations. And he became really interested and he said, Baba, can I do a word splash? And I said, well, I think then the teaching that happens in the family at least still continues. So I mentioned this in order to say that I tested myself by discussing this word responsibility, as a result of which you have this little screen sharing that I requested Parth to do. And you have, on one hand, when you look at this word responsibility, you see there is a word power that comes. Along with that, somebody takes responsibility of something not going right. Somebody takes the blame of it also. So these two, almost diametrically opposite, to be in control and to take the responsibility when things do not go right. There is authority, there is influence, but there is also blame. So all these, the web of words, connotations that this word leads to, this is what I thought I should kind of share with you, with my fellow teachers, the fraternity of teachers. You have given me this opportunity today. And when I picked up this word, I also remembered that, as it is mentioned in our ancient learning, shabd or word can lead to Brahma. That is, the word can actually make us aware of the cosmos. And knowledge actually makes this world knowable for us. So in that sense, always we use the word light with knowledge, or to become enlightened through knowledge. So basically why I thought, when I thought about this word responsibility, along with that, the significance of choosing, or all of you are from various disciplines, but all of you would agree that terms in your disciplines, those are words, terms. And when you have to define terms, when you have to describe terms, it is really a responsibility of a teacher to properly communicate the terms to the students. So if Bhavisha has spoken certain good words for me today, and Parth is smiling, and Tisha is smiling, I can see, it is probably because in the class when we discussed, maybe as a teacher, I have been able to clear a few terms, make them approach the terms without fear, make them a little confident. And where they are today, these confident young teachers, making the department very proud. This is what, with the backdrop against which, when I say the word can lead to the awareness of the cosmos, this is what I mean by that. The knowledge actually makes the world knowable. Another context, Father Benny rightly mentioned once again, that you see, you find that education has been disrupted today. But learning has not been disrupted. Education in the sense that we knew. And since we are speaking now, things are taking into a kind of a new normal, that we find learning from a distance. That yes, so in the conventional sense, education has been disrupted. But learning actually need not require just teachers. We learn from situations. We have learned from this COVID situation how to cope with it. So learning happens from situations. And here, teachers are slightly two steps ahead to convert a situation into learning. This is what I would like to share with you. That a good teacher, a committed teacher, a committed, say, head of the institution, converts the challenge into an opportunity, gives a turn. And in that sense, I would say that learning has not stopped, although in the conventional sense, education might have been disrupted. And therefore, my talk or whatever I'm going to share is going to take you a little bit back to the basics, along with what the way we have evolved into our knowledge, learning, teaching, learning process that we have. If you all remember, during our school times, teacher and students were often looked as opposites, student, teacher, because anyway they were on the two half of the classroom, no? So one teacher versus these many students. So they were often put pitted against each other. Now that you are all teachers, by the way, you realize that there is actually a continuum. The process continues of from a student to a teacher. None of you, I am very sure, who have joined this forum today, none of you have stopped being a student. We remain a student. So this is another context in which I would offer my ideas or thoughts today. And finally, we are at a really exciting stage with the new education policy that has come up or that has been announced, the NEP 2020. I would like to offer a few of my understandings with a few quick readings that I have made and some of the things that I have been hearing from seniors that I revere discussing the new education policies. Well, if I can start with a few guiding mantras that we all follow. So a teacher then ought to be primarily a student. This is what we all agree. So I'm saying a teacher is primarily a student, or a teacher ought to be. When I say ought to be, I also mean that teaching, we should all come to teaching as a choice. It should be a choice that we make that we come into academy. So, you know, if I take my experience, I went out of academics after teaching in a college for 1 year to realize, no, I want to come back into academics. So it is a choice that we all should make. Luckily, with the new education policy, there is going to be space for good teachers. So people who really, that is how I see it. People who really want to take up teaching would find opportunity. I will come to that in a little while. So what I'm saying is that undoubtedly, when you go to the class, whatever discipline of which you are a teacher, you ought to be better in it. I am not using the word best. I am a slightly doubtful person as regards superlatives. So I do not use the word best, because the best can also be bettered. And it's a journey to better oneself. But yes, I am using the word better, which is better than the good. And in our journey, in my journey of 25 years, I have been conscious to be better than the better. So yesterday's better is, I have left it behind to be today's better. And tomorrow I hope to work, strive towards being better than today's better. So there is only better in the comparative sense. And teachers are one group of professionals, probably akin to philosophers, who have certain very deep-seated introspective questions. Introspective questions about their discipline that makes them better in their discipline. Introspective questions about their role in the society. Responsibility, as I say, this is an introspective question. An introspective question about, in general, life. You see, there is a lot of negativity going on these days. People are often becoming very depressed in the last 6 months. And here is another very important role for teachers as counselors. We have to be positive. We have to kind of transfer our positivity onto others. So there are going to be these few guiding mantras that I start with. Obviously, teacher is a good teacher who is able to connect the book to life, and vice versa. Vice versa is also important. Can you select a book that represents life that you can explain? This is, people keep on saying book to life, connect book to life, connect book to life. But what about connecting life and discovering a book that connects life very well? That also is, I think, quite important. And in that sense then, when we speak about striving to be better, knowing, you see, knowing I find knowing is a painfully heavy word. It's a word with a ing with it. It's a continuous process. The moment a teacher says, I know everything, the teacher might as well go to the graveyard. There is no place for such a teacher in the classroom, in any institution. So in that sense, I would, to this young group, I would always say that in this, all of you must be around 30, 35 years, most of you, that is, and you are with great hope that you are beginning your journey as teachers. Always keep in your mind, always keep in front of you teachers that you have known, along with the legendary teachers. One legendary teacher Bhavisha mentioned, and I also remember seeing is knowing, by the way. I remember seeing Abdul Kalam ji here in Rajkot on the Christ campus and on Saurashtra University campus. So these are legendary teachers that we are talking about. And remember, I am I am frightfully aware addressing you in the Christ College. Who better teacher than Christ? I am very, very much aware about whom I am addressing. I am very much aware about the institution whose teachers I am addressing. Who better teacher than Buddha? Who better teacher than, if we look around us, than Vivekananda? Nearby Rajkot, we have Tankara, and the great social reformer comes from there. You will yourself have so many examples to give yourself. So they are all legendary teachers. I am reminded of, for example, Rabindranath Tagore, who spent half of his life in establishing a university at Shantiniketan. He lived for 80 years. He spent 40 years of his life just after establishing Shantiniketan. When the elite intellectual people of Kolkata were sniggering at him, actually, were making fun of him, were scoffing him. He dedicatedly, single-handedly, and then he found supporters like Gandhiji for his cause. 40 years of his life. Look at today. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnanji becomes the president and gives up his summer house, the summer house of his president, Shimla, dedicated to establish an educational institution. And today, the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies is in Shimla, housed in the summer cottage of the president. And that Radhakrishnanji did when he became the president. He says, I don't require this. Let it go to a better cause. Let it go for education. Let it go for learning. So I am aware of that. I speak with the shadows, with the light and the shadows. Shadow I am using as a positive sense. Sometimes we would like to be in the shadow of a good teacher. We would like to remain under the protection of a good teacher. Maybe there is light, paradoxically, light in the shadow in such a situation. And therefore, I, as I address you today, I very, very humbly remember my teachers with whom I have had the great fortune of spending time learning. One of them being, as Bhavisha mentioned, the founder of the Department of English and Comparative Local Studies, Professor Abhesh Kumar Singh. Now, these teachers always remember that great teachers actually have lived a life of teaching. They have never offered a course. It's a kind of a perpetual learning. So they were there in the profession because they chose it inherently, and they live it, and by living it they teach it. And without actually teaching, the masses learn. When I speak of great teachers like Christ, or Guru Nanak or Kabir or Prophet Muhammad, whomsoever you take, why are there so many followers even today, so many centuries later? Which work, which dissertation, PhD did they write? Why are there followers today? It is because, if nothing else, they have offered hope. They have offered meaning to life. And so, in that sense, we have a very tall standard. We teachers have very tall standards in front of us. That is what I'm making myself aware of. So, but this cannot be at an abstract level. You might like to ask a question, sir, what about something practical? I am sitting in front of a classroom. I can see so many teachers with a blackboard behind you, for example. What to do in that sense? So there has to be a few practical tips also. And please take them with a view to reject them immediately. So it is that, or make them better. I have always found that my contribution in the classroom is to make something which is already there slightly different. Maybe by offering an example, maybe by going to the history of the discipline, maybe by comparing something with something and showing the connection. In other words, every time a teacher goes into the class, the responsibility of the teacher, again I come back to the word, is that would I be able to offer at least one new thing for which my entire class is investing its time, energy, money, they are emotionally attached. What would I do? In that sense, of course, you have to, in a way, connect to the frontier of your knowledge. You have to be abreast with whatever is happening at the frontier of your knowledge. In that sense, every teacher ought to be also a kind of a researcher. Which means, by the way, looking at it today, all of you are from different disciplines. Whenever you do a PhD, you get a doctorate of philosophy, by the way. But you have actually done PhD in chemistry. So why philosophy? How does philosophy come? You see, everybody gets a doctorate of philosophy, whether you are doing it in geography or chemistry or computer science or English, wherever you go, you become. It is because philosophy is a kind of an overarching discipline. And even though if you get a PhD in chemistry, the area that you have researched, you have attained philosophical depth in it. Research is more about depth than width. Clearing net is about width, covering this, covering that. Okay, everything is about width, but research is about depth. You attain philosophical depth when you complete research, and therefore you get a doctorate of philosophy. So therefore, every teacher ought to be also a kind of a researcher. And therefore, you can think of developing a kind of a your own methodology, classroom style, classroom methodology. I have always felt that, like, since I come from literature, we speak of style of writers. I've also believed in the style of a teacher. A teacher leaves behind a style, a distinct mark, a way of teaching. And every teacher of all discipline, you will remember your good teachers because they had a unique way of teaching you. So, if we ask a question, who is the teacher today? And we all know that teacher no longer holds the position of holder of knowledge. Although I will slightly differ from what people keep on saying today, that knowledge is available everywhere in Google and this and that, I would still maintain knowledge is not available there, only information is available. A teacher is still a holder of knowledge. I would disagree with the going convention. Teacher holds knowledge, but teacher knows how well to disperse the knowledge contextually. Not in a way page after page that Wikipedia does or Google does. In between, Bonvita advertisement also comes. Okay, not in that sense. Teacher knows how much knowledge in the beginning of the class of the semester and how much knowledge when the semester is coming to an end, in what way to deal with it. Holder and dispenser, disperser of knowledge, teacher still is. So information is all around. But from information to knowledge, I believe three things are required. One is the competence of the learner. Some people learn fast, some people take time. Capacity of the knower, if I can say it, competence, capacity. The second would be resources available. So we all know there are various institutions. Some institutions have plenty of resources, and some institutions unfortunately do not have resources. That makes a difference. Although learners can learn in spite of that. Remember, Abdul Kalam ji came from a very small mufassil school, and yet he reached where he reached, top level scientist basically, and lover of knowledge. So capacity, resources, and of course, as I kept mentioned before, time. Knowledge does not happen overnight. Time is required. Time should be there. So between information converted into knowledge, at least these three steps happen. And therefore, these days there is a new term, knowledge management. You find that every state has a knowledge consortium. So they manage knowledge, where there is certainly production of knowledge after filtering out the unnecessary information, then proper dissemination of knowledge, and then choosing the proper channel of dissemination. Today in this technological world, we also have to keep in mind what is the channel of disseminating knowledge. Also, knowledge management means that there has to be an outcome of learning, in vision at least. There has to be a vision of an institution teaching something, but what would be the outcome of learning? There has to be a site at the frontier of knowledge, where teachers go, do their FDPs, they improve themselves, they attend conferences, seminars, learn. So those opportunities, those events must be plain, must be plain. And ultimately, you should think of passing on knowledge, so that continuity of the human chain has to be there. So this, at least, these are the things that we are discussing today when we speak about knowledge management. And a lot of these ideas, dear colleagues and friends, you will find, I would really ask you to spend more than 2 hours studying the new education policy, and you will find it worth rewarding. First thing that I thought about is that, well, finally we have again the Ministry of Education back. There was earlier in the 80s a Ministry of Education, then it became MHRD. Now it is Ministry of Education again. Education somehow is a wider, deeper word than just human resources. When we speak of, I feel again, with my knowledge and emphasis on words and terms, I think Ministry of Education has been reshaped, revamped. That is something good. Now this document itself, as I see the document, and since we are all teachers, we have to address this document somehow or the other. One point I find is strengthening local language and local knowledge, but not rejecting the other. See, there is no rift being created between the West and the East. That would be futile in these days, by the way, where you do not know where East comes and where West goes, and anyway in a globe, what is East and what is West? It keeps on turning. Globe and globalization, these things do not matter these days. But what is happening is that there would be a lot of local knowledge in the local language available, and why not discover them? Why not strengthen them? And therefore, in a way, from school to university, the vision document of the new education policy attempts to look at education holistically. This is another thing that I have noted. Often at the university level, all of you have attended universities, and because you are teachers, you have been better students. You know that your own classmates were not all that good. I give you my example, the example from my discipline. When people come to do ME, and I think all these English teachers would agree, there are so many students who come to do ME because they want to improve their English. We keep on telling them, coming to do MA in English will not improve your English. You need a certain standard of English in the very first place to be able to enter master's level. So it is not about bhasha, Angreji bhasha, English language that you are going to improve. Here you are to get critical skills. And critical skill, a critical mind is what is emphasized also in the new education policy. To enhance, to sharpen the student's critical mind towards. Fundamental concepts should be made clear. A critical bent of mind should be developed. These are some of the things when we are talking about the holistic approach. So if you are strengthening the students right from the school level, eventually you will get better graduate students, and eventually you will get better postgraduate students. Eventually, vision document has 2040 as its target, by the way. By 2040, India is supposed to be the global leader of knowledge. Once again, India was once the global leader of knowledge with our great institutions like Nalanda and Takshashila. And Vallabhipur, very close to where we are, near Bhavnagar. So India was once, and India will be again. That's the vision. By 2040, India will become. So in that sense, there is an outcome. There is a learning outcome. There is a vision document outcome. And as I mentioned just a few minutes before, there is a great emphasis on good teachers. You will find that now people who want to take up teaching by choice will have more opportunities. More opportunities will be created. And therefore, teaching learning process will be improved automatically. Research will improve automatically. And therefore, again, overall education will improve. Another important thing that this does, you know, we all live in a world where the science and humanities are divided, as if there is a great chasm between science and arts or science and humanities. So there is also a tendency by the science people to look down upon arts, which again I would mention that this is a false perception. What is being done is to bridge the so-called gap between humanities and the sciences. Let me ask you the question to ponder about people who are in computer science and electronics, for example. What is going to be the position of the human when we are speaking of digital humanities? So look at the term digital humanities. There is humanities and there is this, the artificial intelligence word digital there. Both have to be kept together. And this is one thing that the new education policy attempts to do, try to bridge the gap between knowledges. Actually, it is leading to interdisciplinarity. There are all various disciplines, like you are all various teachers of various disciplines today. And there has to be linkages or bridges between disciplines of knowledge. That is one thing that the policy tries to do. And this has been proposed that every district must have a university. What does it mean from the management of education side? That all the white elephants of huge big universities with 300 affiliating colleges, this and that, would go away, become a thing of the past. Small is beautiful because small is manageable. Small is flexible. And in this context, since teachers are also prophets, let me also say that the way you are shaping up from 2001 I see in the near future Christ College becoming a Christ University. You can yourself, you have the strength, diversity, you can become, and so let there be competition. There would be, there has to be. Every district will have one university. That is what the policy says, which means what? There would be more institutions of knowledge, which is good news for all you young teachers. You would have good places to select, to go to. So we just hope that the implementation is done soon, and we are in our, I might not be seeing my see this in my career, but I pray that you see it, you young teachers, you live in this exciting times of the things that the new education policy talks about or visualizes. In this context that we are talking about, as I just said, globalization has taught us that the world is not homogeneous. Often people talk about globalization as one kind of a plane, the world is flat kind of a discourse that Thomas Friedman wrote a book. But world is really heterogeneous. There are so many societies, so many people, so many ideas and ideology. And therefore, you find friction between cultures. Multiculturalism leads to friction. Multiculturalism leads to harmony also. The goal should be harmony. But often harmony arrives through friction. Like a Nausicaa violin player like me, if I start playing the violin, first of all, only scratches and noise will come out. Then somebody will teach me, please hold the bow in this manner, hold your violin in that manner, then hopefully you can make some music out of all this scratching. So before harmony is an end process, which is a very difficult thing to achieve. First, there is always clash and friction. And in this era of communication and so-called connectivity, we are all so wired and connected. But one has to think, where is the human touch? You all have 400 friends on your FB, 900 friends on your WhatsApp, and not even 3 friends to whom you can go to. Now that's a dangerous situation that we all are living in. We have to think about this kind of communication and connectivity also. And when there is so much of privatization and corporatization is happening, we all also have to look at the what is now being called the social responsibility of the corporates or the CSR, and how that actually is happening. Some of the corporates are really doing very good job. Their social commitment is really very good. And also we live in the times of more abuses by the media than its uses. But then again, it is a debatable thing that you all can talk about, or all of you can think. And so we are in the 21st century, commerce driven versus knowledge driven. You can see two kinds of institutions of education there right now. See all around you that is education to be only profit driven, or actually fundamentals of education should be taken care of in these times we are in. Towards the end of my talk, then I would remind all of us to two very urgent things that we all need to think of, whichever discipline we belong. First thing is a sense of awareness of the environment. Whether it is science, whether it is commerce, whether it is literature, we all need to be now aware like never before about the environment. And therefore, you will find even in literature, there is something called ecological criticism being taught so many institutions, and it has made a presence there. Everyone in any discipline, whichever discipline, we have to become aware about what is happening to our environment. This is, and if more awareness, more knowledge, more education, only then. We cannot go back to our old times when there was no pollution, no machines. That we cannot backtrack that. But we have to use our knowledge to make it better. And secondly, of course, education has still not achieved equity. Equity, equality and choices. Equality of choices, whether it is gender, whether it is certain communities being left out. So equity is a very important thing. So as a teacher, when you enter your classroom, in your classroom, there cannot be any favorite students. A favorite student is one who first will prove his or her student-giri by being a good student. I'm using the Gandhi-giri word, of course. So in that sense, a favorite student becomes favorite after being a student, not when. So you can ask your Bhavisha madam when I used to scold her to the point of tears, but now she is such a dear colleague. Okay, so there cannot be any favorite student. There cannot be. There has to be equity. And then let us see if we become kind of a fulcrum to bring about this empowerment in all, or that is what. So finally, what can a teacher offer? What can we all offer? We finally, hopefully, will leave behind a story, a narrative. Everybody is a storyteller. Whichever discipline you belong to. Remember, every legendary teacher first began as a very approachable teacher. Moral of the story is, believe in legends. Don't disbelieve legends. Every legendary teacher began as a very believable, approachable teacher, and then became a legendary teacher. And finally, the use of a teacher is to become useless. If you quote unquote use of a teacher, because by then a teacher would have passed on the baton to a cadre of learners who are into the society, doing the good job that they have learned from their teachers. I use the word teachers in plural, not in singular. And they would go along, they would take your idea 10%, another teacher's idea 7%, another teacher's idea, their own creativity, their own ideas 50%, because they have to be their own. And then thus will come this totality, this holisticness that we are talking about. I will end with a few lines from what I like teaching, poetry, and not few lines, just 2-3 lines, because others might then fall asleep. Poetry is considered to be very difficult. Not everybody's glass of nimbu pani, as they say, cup of tea, glass of nimbu pani, or glass of plain water. That over these 25 years, by the way, I find, what's the big deal? I think we have not had good poetry teachers. And I put a finger at my own fraternity. If we have good history teachers, we would love history. If we have good arithmetic teacher, mathematics teacher, we would love arithmetic and mathematics. If we have good poetry teacher, we would fall in love with poetry. So it's not a big deal. It is as difficult or as easy as any other subject. And there is poetry everywhere, whether we want to see it or not. In these times, when the very air that we breathe can take our life, But then again, if we don't breathe, we are dead anyway. So isn't the life itself today very, very poetic, paradoxically poetic? Although there need not be poetic justice always, but it can be. So there is this mythical figure, Ulysses, who has been depicted in so many literary works. And a line that I will quote as I end is a line from poet Alfred Tennyson, whose poem Ulysses ends with the line, "To strive, to seek, to find." I repeat, to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. Thank you very much, all of you, the Cultural Committee of Christ College, who did not find the latest photograph I sent to be culturally appropriate. Don't blame me. When you see on the poster 50 years ago, Mukherjee sir, and now you see me in this old age, 50 plus, that is responsibility of your cultural group who did not find my this present photograph culturally disseminable, or whatever I can say. But I am thankful to you all. I'm thankful to entire Team Christ College and the cultural group. I have really high hopes from this institution. I quite love this institution, simply speaking, there is no other word. And I'm really very enthused to be amongst with you sharing my ideas. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was indeed a very stimulating session, the way in which you depicted right from the mind mapping or the splash that Devu prepared. And it was really intriguing, the various aspects that you dealt, taking into consideration the NEP and the various other aspects. The session is now open to question and answers. I would request the faculty members to either post their questions here in the chat box, or you can also unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, I shall be happy to take your observations.
Bhavisha, I think there are two questions from Swati madam and Tony madam, which you can inform sir about.
Yes. So the first question is by Dr. Swati Doshi. Adam asks that how does a teacher impart ethical values in the present digital world where human touch seems disappearing? And also Sony madam has posted another question asking to focus more on the teachers versus the artificial intelligence. So how should teachers tackle this in today's present scenario?
I don't have a mantra, obviously, but if you look around yourself, this generation, my son's generation, my daughter's generation, they are so comfortable with devices, electronic devices. And if we can guide them, we cannot snatch the devices from them. If we can guide what they should see in the devices, the devices, the digital thing actually might propel them to be ethical, moral. Through them they can learn it. For example, there was a beautiful cartoon about a lion cub and the relationship with the mother and the father. Beautifully done, background score, everything very nice. One thing that we should not strive to do is we should not be hectoring them. We should not be pointing out time and again. No, we should not be treaterly to them. Because the world that they are in, we cannot deny that world. We cannot shut out that world. The challenge before us, and therefore I do not have an answer because we are still finding answers. The challenge before us is to how to best use, optimally use artificial intelligence, digital devices, our Siris and Alexas, to turn towards real human beings, real problems of real human beings, real human situations. For example, I quite liked this initiative that an NGO group from Rajkot has started doing. They are asking people to donate their old phones, donate their old digital devices. So what happens is that we are placed in households with plentiful of devices, but can we think of donating one? So that people who, again, it becomes that inequality, if we can do it. Now that would be through a digital device, a human to human touch. I'm giving just one example. And so the answer to both these questions would be ethics. We never learned ethics only by going to certain teachers. We recognized ethics, our generation. Recognized ethics and values. Similarly, if we can create situations, or maybe through digital devices, create situations for this generation to become aware of ethics and values, then our job is done. Yeah.
So there's one more question. In fact, there are a few more. The other one is by Mr. Jacob Tripathi. Sir asked that these days there's a huge level of opposition that is faced by the teachers from the side of the parents towards online learning, even though they do not know about how it actually works. So any answers to these?
Actually, this whole situation is new for everyone. For parents, for students, for teachers who are trying to cope up, all of you would be finding one thing, that online is more stressful than physical. You would be feeling this. And why is it so? Because it's a kind of a paradigm shift that has happened suddenly. So what I am doing is, I am preparing my on paper notes, then I am trying to convert it into some digital platform, then I am telling that, sending that. So I think I'm working more in that sense. Good teaching is going to be recognized as good teaching, whether it is online, whether it is in person. So if parents are bothered, I think parents and teachers must have a kind of an interface digitally, and let their questions be enumerated, and your team of teachers sit across. Maybe you can take the questions one day, and then next day all of you sit panel of teachers and address the questions. You cannot run away from the questions. There would be questions. So teachers now think that there were earlier questions only from students. Now parents have also joined. There are two kinds of question seekers. But that's an opportunity. If your parents are convinced, they will convince their children. Don't worry about it. Yes, please.
So we have another question, especially it would interest you more answering to this one. It is posed by Dr. Arvindan Nair. Sir asks, what can be done to have good poetry teachers, and why is it that we don't have good poetry teachers, though we have many great poets?
There is a fundamental distinction between a creative writer and a teacher critic, I have always felt. I have seen in my experience great creative writers who are pathetic teachers. They cannot teach their own work, let me tell you. So one thing I would suggest, and so that you take it and you can suggest to all creative writers, that you remain in your creative world. You write, you give us good work, Don't try to explain your own work. Leave that to teachers and critics and reviewers. So that is one thing. There is a distinction between a good writer, good poet, and a good teacher of poetry. A good teacher of poetry need not be a good poet, but might have great poetic sensibility. Now, this is one thing, Dr. Nair, you would find that artists are very few in the minority in the society. Any artist of any art, okay? So that would always be, maybe because I keep on saying, for example, everybody can narrate a story. So we all start from the equal platform, but only some become writers. So maybe because they have taken and it is a very solitary task to become an artist. One has to ask this question to students. Do you want to become an artist? And students would run away. No, sir, I would die of poverty, they would say. Because there are more stories of artists remaining poor all their lives and their foundation becoming rich after their death, by the way. What good is it to them? But like teaching is a dedication, art is some kind of a dedication. Going after any knowledge is a kind of a dedication. So if we have dedicated teachers arousing the dedication, then probably we can see teachers who are passionate about poetry, knowledgeable about poetry. So I think it has to start from the level where people start becoming interested in nursery rhymes. Two, difficult poems that even a teacher of poetry does not understand and comes to the class pretending that he or she understands. And sometimes the meaning comes out in the discussion between the teacher and the student and the work in the classroom.
So there's last question that we'd like to take up.
Please.
This is posed from the Polytechnic Institution that in today's scenario, as we teach online, we have taken to digital platforms, we're somewhere losing this human touch, and due to which student retention is difficult. So what are the parameters or what can the strategies be to retain the student attention as well as to provide this human touch?
Anybody becomes very interested in watching a riveting movie, even though the movie is 90 minutes long minimally. Our Bollywood movies are 2.5 hours long. During my generation, my youth, we had 3 hour long movies like Sholay. The point is that even your online teaching, one point I mentioned in my sharing is you have to introspect how to make it more interesting. You have to work on it. If you make your online talk as interesting as your in-person talk, then people would retain. See, the classroom is made up of three kinds of students. 5% students who would learn in spite of the teachers. For example, I don't know who is reading deeply the autobiography of Abdul Kalam ji. All his teachers were certainly not inspiring. He became a great person in spite of his teachers. Right? I mentioned Rabindranath Tagore. He never went to any school or university. He did homeschooling. Okay. And technically he was not a very brilliant student. Gandhiji was not a very brilliant student. So in that sense, then there would be 5% of students who are self-learners. At the opposite end, there are 5% of students to whom even Einstein would not be able to teach. So they will remain that way. I mean, unfortunately, that is. The classroom consists of 90% students whom the teacher can really make a difference. And the teacher has to target this 90% student. Yes, of course, if the teacher tries very well, the first 5% student will also become interested. I don't know about the last 5% students, but the 5%. So the teacher actually is looking at 95% of the classroom. You have to make, for example, I don't think anybody, I myself, when I woke up today, I never thought yesterday night, I thought I will be using PowerPoint-like pages. But today in the morning, I gave you a word splash. Word splash, I think many of you will remember only the word splash. And you will all forget all the bakwas that I have done after the word splash. So, but what is the takeaway for you? One page of 10 different words emanating out from one word responsibility. So if you think back, or if your spouse today asks ki 2 ghanta bitaye aise phone laga ke kya kiya, responsibility, so you will say, dear, responsibility ke bare mein responsibly socha maine. So that is the thing, that if you make your talk interesting online, in person, you have to introspect how to vary it, how to differentiate. I think your classes would be attended. I saw 70 plus people during the beginning. I now see 62 people. That's fair enough. That's really fair enough. Okay. So I have to thank all of you to still be in front of your screen. Yeah. Thank you so much.
I believe the number going down would be probably, due to the issues.
Don't worry. I'm saying it's a healthy, very, very good number. I'm really very happy.
I think, sir, we've had a very interesting and stimulating discussion as well after your talk. And therefore, I'd really like to thank you. But before that, to follow the code of conduct, I'd like Mr. Parth Joshi to kindly propose a vote of thanks.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
All right. Respected Professor Mukherjee, Reverend Father Dr. Benny, esteemed principals of both Christ College and Christ Polytechnic Institute, dear teachers and colleagues, it's indeed an honor and privilege to be proposing thanks to you all after this enriching session. I think let me begin with a quote about Mukherjee sir's one of the favorite teacher critics, Professor F.R. Lewis, who was one of the most popular teachers of English at Cambridge. He was, as sir rightly said, one among the cadre of learners created by Professor I.A. Richards, who, as sir has taught us, was one of the initial teachers of the first English department established at Cambridge University around 100 years back. Professor F.R. Lewis, a student, says about him, and I quote, "He was really superb. I remember the feelings with which I and this man would come away. I would be partly exhilarated because of the new insights and the fine discriminations he made, and sobered because of such high professional standards in his insight, and one just realized how unskilled one was as a reader. At the same time, there was no feeling of being belittled in any way. If you had difficulties and raised objections, he met you on those. He could scrape whatever he was going to say and just meet you on whatever you were interested in," unquote. And I'm sure at least all my colleagues at the Department of English of Christ College would agree that these words would easily be applicable to Professor Mukherjee without any exaggeration, as much as Professor F.R. Lewis. Sir is an undisputed scholar and a strict but compassionate teacher, an estimate of which can be got from the fact that as soon as this information about the talk today was shared on various social media platforms, we had within an hour's time dozens of students, alumni, research scholars, teachers, not only from English but from departments like management and electronics also, asking for the link of this session to join. So thank you, sir. Thank you for teaching us to persevere in our pursuit of knowledge. Thank you for accepting my invitation, our invitation, on a single phone call. I wouldn't say thank you for sparing your valuable time, but rather thank you for spending your valuable time in a meaningful way with us. I also express my gratitude to Reverend Father Benny and Principal Madam for allowing Cultural Club to have this virtual celebration of Teachers' Day and supporting us in all possible ways. And last but not the least, I, on behalf of the club, thank all the 65 plus attendees from across Christ Campus for being a part of this stimulating session. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I'd like to bring about a close to this online talk by only quoting John Ruskin when he says that education is a painful, continual and difficult work to be done in kindness, by watching, by warning, by praise, but above all by example. And that's how, when we listen to Mukherjee sir so intensively, grasping each and every word that he uttered, I think sir happens to be a role model for all of us, an anchor who we are hooked to and a model that who we look up to. So thank you so much, sir, for setting an example for all of us. And a very happy Teachers' Day to all the teachers who have taught me and various others at the department and my colleagues. Thank you,
sir. Happy Teachers' Day to all of you. Yeah. May the journey of learning continue.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Close.